Good morning, Eric Boehlert.
Hey, how are you?
I'm good. You, one of your tweets is my favorite. You said, if the GOP pays no price, they're not going to stop lying. I mean, it is astounding. I mean, not just the lengths they go to cover for this president and to lie for him or to back up his lies, right? But that they'll twist themselves because Trump will undercut them a day later, right? And then they look like idiots.
Yeah, I mean, Lindsey Graham is dangling in the wind, right? So after are we saying the S word on your show?
No, we are not, sir.
Okay, thank you. So after the S word, whole story broke, you know, the White House said, it's great. You know, it's going to play with the base. A White House official told CNN it was taking, quote, a victory lap. So that indicates to the rest of the Republican Party, okay, they're happy with it. We think it's weird, but... And so then Lindsey Graham essentially confirmed what he had said, and he confirmed to a Republican, Tim Scott from South Carolina. So now, 3 days later, Keystone Cops, routine breaks out, and the White House has changed its story. You know, Tom Cotton and Senator Perdue go on TV, called Durbin a liar, say, he made it up. You know, we were in the room. You know, on Friday they said we remember. On Sunday they said he definitely didn't say it. And where does that leave Lindsey Graham? Because they will undercut anyone, and they will change 180 or 360 or whatever the math is on this thing.
Yeah, but the other thing is Lindsey Graham didn't have the courage to say it.
I know.
He tells Tim Scott, then he kind of says, "Oh, this oblique sort of I said what I said back to him," and you know, implying that he did say it, but not just coming right out and saying it, right, and condemning it.
You know, maybe in the back of his mind, he said, you know what? These people are crazy. They might change their story in 2 days, so I can't go on TV and give a definitive answer because who knows with these people? But, yeah, he kind of got rewarded. I think the Saturday New York Times front page headline, you know, Republican, you know, senator scolded Trump. Well, we don't have any on-the-record confirmation of that. I mean, Senator Graham has never turned down a TV interview until the last 72 hours because he doesn't want to talk about it. But again, someone did a good quote from him today. His quote was, you know, up on the Hill saying his memory has not evolved, sort of taking a jab at Cotton and Perdue. But yeah, I mean, this is all, you know, in a larger scheme of things, you know, the government shuts down on Friday because they're supposed to be working towards a DACA deal, a Dreamer deal, a wall deal. And Trump blew all of this up. And people forget, what triggered this controversy was three Republicans, three Democrats went to the White House with a bipartisan deal to try to avoid a government shutdown.
That he said he liked on the phone, right? That he said, and then they get there, and there's all these extra people in the meeting that who I assume just talked to him, like Tom Cotton.
They're wearing polos and khakis.
Because as we know, right, like whoever talks to him last, so by the time they get to the White House... Now he's, you know, asshole this and asshole that, and right.
Right, and I saw a quote this week, someone saying, you know, Stephen Miller is basically running the immigration negotiation out of the White House. Look, this is what happens when, you know, the president doesn't know anything about anything. You know, he's just this empty vessel. So, right, the last person who spews kind of garbage into the top of his head, that's his policy for the 12 minutes. And it sounds like if he was that mad at this reasonable proposal, Stephen Miller was probably pumping him up before the meeting.
Yeah.
But again, this is all just more, you know, Keystone Cops. They don't know up from down. And here's the amazing thing: the Republican Party still covers for this guy.
Yeah.
You know, he makes them look like fools every day of the week, and yet there aren't four Republican senators who will break away and say, you know what, this is madness.
Yeah, I mean, Paul Ryan, the best he can muster, right, is, it's it's unhelpful.
Unhelpful.
It's unfortunate.
You know, when you grab, you know, unhelpful, I mean, that doesn't even begin to describe what's going on here. But, they just keep covering for him, and it's amazing to watch. And, again, the larger scheme, you know, the government shuts down Friday, basically a year anniversary of Republicans taking control of the federal government.
Well, yeah, you wrote a piece on this. I mean, and of course, as usual, his tweets are ridiculous. Democrats just want to shut down the government and take money away from the military. And you wrote a piece saying that Trump is causing real angst for military families. He said if there's a shutdown, it's a very, very simple vote to make sure troops and veterans aren't affected. The only reason for Trump to not promise he'll call for and sign such a bill is so he can hold troops and veterans for ransom, said the Vote Vets director. His unwillingness to just say troops and veterans won't be affected is causing real angst for military families. This guy should never be allowed to say he's pro-troop and pro-veteran again.
So the context and the background is in 2013 when the government shut down, Obama signed a bill making sure the troops would be paid during a government shutdown.
Yeah.
Trump could do the same, but he's not willing to do so. A, he's not willing to do so because he realizes, you know, he doesn't want to basically acknowledge the government is going to shut down. Obama signed it because Republicans were the ones who wanted to shut down the government. Trump is, and Republicans are in charge of every lever of power in the federal government, and so they don't want to concede, oh, by the way, we're going to fail at this, and we're going to fail on Friday, so we're going to protect the troops. So he's not willing to do that. So if this government shuts down under the Republican management, troops will not be paid as of right now, which is mind-boggling.
And he's on record as saying maybe we could use a good shutdown, right? I mean, and it you're right.
I forgot about that. That's right.
Yeah. But it is astounding. You're right. When they control all three branches, that of course he's going to blame Democrats, and
Yeah, he lives in this la-la land. He thinks Democrats are going to be blamed, and he thinks this is going to be great for Republicans. I mean, you know, there's a reason. Representative McCarthy. There was a report over the weekend. He's number two or three in the House. He's told Trump, "We're going to lose the House." Like, you know, this thing is growing and growing and growing. We saw ISA retire last week. We saw Royce retire last week. We've talked about this. I mean, Democrats have to pick up 24 seats. They might pick up 12 in California.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not an exaggeration to say the Republican Party essentially will not exist in the state of California after next November.
Yay.
So
another reason California is great.
Trump thinks this is, you know, if there's going to be a shutdown, he's going to blame Democrats. It's not going to work that way. They own all of this. And as going back to our original point regarding the, you know, the S-hole controversy, their messaging is a disaster. You've got half the Republican Party saying he didn't say it, and then we've got other members of the party saying, yes, he said it. So if they think they're going to devise this master messaging strategy for a government shutdown, again, you know, everyone in that White House is living in a fantasy land.
Well, yeah, I mean, and I don't want to, you know, as I keep saying, register to vote, get your ID, get someone else registered. I don't want to get complacent, but you're right. There's starting to be stories, not just the House, Eric, but the Senate, governorships. I mean, I don't know about you, but I really do feel a blue tsunami coming on.
Yeah, I do, too. And remember, the Republicans, you know, the Senate was supposed to be absolutely safe, right? The Democrats have to defend so many seats. But again, what happened last week? You know, the hotshot young Republican in Ohio said, oh, by the way, I'm not going to run for Senate. A hotshot Republican businessman in New York said, oh, I'm not going to run for governor. They are dropping like flies. These guys are not dumb, and they are mostly guys. You know, they have their consultants. They're doing the polling numbers. They're looking at the fundraising. Everyone knows. If you have a choice, you sit out 2018 if you're a Republican.
Yep. Well, you know, Eric, you always talk about, you know, more importantly, the media coverage of all this. And I just, how do we get to a point where you can't just say the president is clearly a racist, he is clearly a liar? I think it's, you know, the way this has all been normalized to the point where him paying off a porn star a few days before the election is not even the top story of the day. Like, you and I would just, our heads will explode if we have to say if Hillary had or if Obama had, right?
Or if Bill Clinton.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. I don't think it was discussed on any of the Sunday network Sunday shows. And as I tweeted yesterday, you know, if Bill Clinton had paid a porn actress hush money on the eve of the election, the Sunday shows would have had to expand to 3 hours just to get in.
They'd be on Monday.
All the outrage. Yeah, they'd be still on right now.
Meet the Monday.
Exactly. So, and look, and you know, I saw a couple, you know, some people on Twitter. I don't care about that. That's just his private life. That's consensual. He's kind of a dirtbag. We knew that. I'm sorry, paying hush money weeks before the election. If we're just going to wave that off as saying, oh, that's okay,
yeah.
A, did this come from his foundation? B, did this money come from his campaign? Those are both illegal. Robert Mueller should absolutely 100% ask Trump about these payments if and when he Trump has the guts to sit down and ask him for it. I mean, yeah. My God, this is Bill Clinton times 10. And instead of going into cardiac arrest, the press is having the opposite reaction. They're going into this comatose daze where, well, you know, that's Trump being Trump.
Yeah, and in this same three-day news cycle, they have apparently faked a letter from not just a porn star, but a White House doctor. you had a piece on Cher Blue, right? There was a piece on Cher Blue about the fact that so he has the White House physical, and so they've released, ostensibly this is from the doctor, his name is misspelled, right? And just says he's in excellent health.
Right, just like remember when Trump had that tweet where he said, he was talking about the Russia probe, and he says pled guilty, and Trump's attorney says, oh, I actually wrote that tweet. As if there's two attorneys in America that once they pleaded. And I've never written a tweet of his before, but I wrote that one. So yeah, and so if you look at this letter from Trump's quote doctor, it sounds a lot like Donald Trump. It sounds like one of the Trump publicists. Remember, Trump used to call up the New York Post under a fake name and talk about how wonderful Donald Trump is.
Oh God!
So there's certainly indications he's still doing that. In his bed eating cheeseburgers, in the White House.
Well, listen, we were discussing last hour how to handle the State of the Union, whether or not to go, and
I know.
And Alonzo Bowden said if Democrats went and yelled "You lie," they'd run out of breath by the. By the sentence, right?
Look, and there is an actual danger in that. I mean, it's not just the press who normalizes. I think everyone does. The fact that he's golfing on MLK Day, the fact that he was golfing during the Hawaii alert, and in a weird way, people are just kind of they've come to terms with it. He's just a lazy oaf, and he's gonna golf a lot, so. There's a danger that all of this stuff, among everyone, including me, it just kind of does become normalized. But again, going back to this porn star story, I'm sorry. Paying hush money weeks before a presidential election, if that's not a story, then every journalist in America should just go home.
Yeah, how about in Fire and Fury when Bannon said that it had to be about 100 women?
Right. And what happened? Right. And the other part of that passage was, what happened to Trump's attorney who set all those up? This was Trump's attorney for 20 years, and then suddenly this year he just kind of disappeared and went home, which is the other point Bannon was making in that passage, and also suggesting there were 100 women that he kind of fixed. So come on. I mean, we crucified a Democrat, and I guarantee you the press is just going to, this is not permanent. If a Democratic president, when a Democratic president returns, the White House, the press is going to absolutely go back to their old rules.
Yeah. Someone tweeted this morning, I didn't see it, but they said, someone on Morning Joe, literally this morning, said Trump was the lesser of two evils. Oh my God. I mean, and once again, how we got here, right?
I know. I mean, that comment in January 2017 would be maddening. In 2018, it's just...
Yeah, it's just, okay. I can't even. All right, Eric, we'll see you next week. All right,
good luck.
Thank you. All right. Eric has never ended just muttering.
No.